like, Paul Madden, just keep an eye on him.
I'm usually the heckler myself. I'm the one that gets thrown out.
Okay, guys and girls, welcome to the first in our series of Pro Talks on behalf of Kinvara United FC. And we're just going to give everyone a moment or two to come in, and hopefully everyone can hear me. I know Rob, who is joining us here, and I'll get to Rob in a second, was on his way to an office, but he is stuck in a ferry. So, but I see him here loud and clear. At least he's got the hair done. He's not wearing the Pacific FC jersey, but we'll forgive him for that. So let me just give everyone about another 10 seconds and then we will kick it off. Okay, everyone can hear me okay? Yeah, just confirming, thumbs up. Great. Okay, so officially welcome to Pro Talk. So this is a series of interviews being conducted on behalf of Kinvara United FC. And the whole idea is to bring people from within the game and people who have been in the game, either played professionally, still play right now, our own clubs, et cetera, et cetera. And the whole idea is for this to give something back to the community, the members, and I suppose showcase people so we can learn about football itself. We can learn about the technical side of it, but also maybe some of the business side of it as well. So our first guest today is Rob Friend. And Rob is coming to us, I believe, from a ferry somewhere in British Columbia in Canada. Rob, everyone has a sense of who you are and what you've done in the game based on the event page. Hopefully all of it is pretty accurate, if not entirely accurate. If there's anything we missed, let us know. So I wanted to, first of all, welcome you, Rob. And where are you right now?
Yeah, no, thanks, Phil. I'm just getting off the ferry. And as Philip knows, in Victoria, British Columbia, here in Canada, it's an island. So to get anywhere, you have to hop on and off a ferry. So it seems a little bit, out. But that's how we travel, and so that we're stuck in fog. But I'm ready for this.
Great. Phil's
warned me that he's going to come after me, so let's bring it.
Okay, cool. Well, very quickly, how I met Rob was through our daughter Maggie, who's also on the call here today with Mum. And when you move to a foreign country, it is sometimes difficult to meet people and make friends and so on. Or maybe it's just because of my personality. Who knows? But I came back one day from work and I said to my wife, I said, you know, that couple, Rob and Mary, that we bumped into at school, the kids, it'd be lovely to get to know them and maybe go out for dinner sometime. And Pauline looks at me very pale faced and said, that's going to be a problem. And I said, why? She said, oh, yeah, Maggie, our sweet little daughter, punched Layla, Rob and Mary's daughter, in the face today in school. And I was thinking, oh, well, there you go. Fast forward a few weeks, I met Rob in the car park and I said, when is the lawyer's letter coming our way? And he said, why? And I said, because our daughter hit your daughter in the face. He goes, oh, God, she deserved it, I'm sure. And then I knew we'd be good friends moving forward. Rob, I'm going to hit you with some quick fire questions to get straight into it. Are you ready to go?
Yeah, no, I'm ready. I'm ready. I love that story. Typical Irish girl. Punching my Canadian daughter in the face, but it's a great one.
So let's get straight into it. Then we're going to do some Q&A towards the end here. What's your top moment? If you look back over your playing career, what is the top moment that just stands out short and sweet?
Oh, wow. That's a great question. It was interesting. I was talking to my dad who was visiting for the last week and sort of reflecting on my career, 12 years professionally, playing around the world, mainly in Germany. And I was kind of telling him, because we were watching the Canadian national team play last night, also played for Canada. And it's not until after your career, and this is probably applies to life, is really, you don't appreciate it till later. So, I'm now 41. It's been 6 years since I've been retired. And as I get older, I appreciate more and more the career I had, the moments I've had. And because we were talking, and I see some of my actual former teammates that are still playing for Canada. We're very close to qualifying for this year's World Cup. And, I'm just proud to see some of my guys still on the field playing, winning, most likely going to the World Cup for the first time since 1986. And it was funny because the sort of feeling I had wasn't about one moment in particular. And I think the answer, Phil, to your question is, it was more than just the one goal or the one moment on the field. And what I missed most, and again, reflecting is my teammates and the experiences with my teammates. And you don't appreciate that until later. And I see some of my teammates on there and they're like brothers for life, like brothers. And whether you're a youth player, a pro player, you went to war together. And sitting here 6 years later after I've been retired, that's what I miss most. And I think that's probably actually really what I got out of my career was playing with my brothers and competing and going to war and battling. And that those are the moments you don't realize when you're playing because you're focused on the game, the goals, performing, you know, contracts, trying to make it to the next level, always trying to strive for that. But it's not till later until you appreciate it's actually more than that, than just those little moments in your career.
Let me jump in, and you may have already kind of alluded to this to some extent. What is the lowest point in your career, if you don't mind me asking?
Well, funny
because
enough,
I think, and I asked that question, Rob, not to catch you out, obviously, because we haven't rehearsed any of this, and I haven't submitted questions to you. I ask you that question because there tends to be a lot of focus on the sexy stuff in life, on social media and stuff like that, and I think it's important sometimes to recognize that there are lows, and I'm just wondering, you know, what that is for you.
Yeah, no, you know, you're definitely catching me off. So I'm not prepared. So I'm definitely just going off the cuff here. There's certainly as a professional athlete or as an athlete in general, I would say there's more lows than highs. The highs are what everyone sees. It's the lows that people don't see. It's the lows we don't talk about. It's the lows that we're not posting on social media or in front of everybody. It's the highs. And you know, there's a conversation right now with athletes and mental health. And, you know, I think athletes, the personalities to reach that highest level, you tick differently. There's something off. And it's those low moments that actually are clearly the most challenging parts of your career that you learn to live with. And, you know, I've had many low moments, and I'm going to just tell one quick story and this sort of comes with playing and pressure. I had a huge transfer from one German club to another, Mönchengladbach to Hertha Berlin, big club in Germany, capital city, 6 million people. This was the club of Berlin. And so there I was the big striker they paid a lot of money for. So with a lot of money comes a lot of pressure on your shoulders. So I'm there for the first few months. I'm playing games, scored a couple goals as a striker. Everybody judges you on your goals. And so a few weeks go by, I'm not scoring, I'm playing poorly, the team's in a funk, normal in sports, and Berlin is a tough city, a lot of East Germans there, so they're pretty ruthless, they're known to be ruthless fans, 70,000 every game in the Olympia Stadium. I had gone through a rough patch there, and what sticks out was the low moment. It's probably 6 or 7 games in, I hadn't scored, the fans are on me, you know, they paid a lot of money for me. And the newspapers were all over at that time. Newspapers was the main source of media. And so they're all over me. They're scrutinizing the car I drive, the clothes I wear, the shoes I have, literally in the newspaper. Look at this guy driving this fancy Mercedes. Who does he think he is? Like that's, they would attack you and the fans would read it and jump all over it. So the low moment in that time was 70,000. We had a big derby game against another club called Union Berlin. The big game in Berlin. We're the big club. We're the sexy club. And again, this was probably my 6th or 7th game I hadn't scored. And there was a moment there where I was done mentally. I didn't even want the ball. I didn't want the ball. I was scared to receive the ball because there was so much pressure on me at that time. And I was in such a low moment that I remember one moment in the game, I received the ball and my confidence was rock bottom. And I had a horrible touch. I think it went out, probably off my knee, something like that. And the entire, I'd say 60,000, because 10,000 were the away supporters, started whistling and booing. And I remember looking around and just seeing fans' face, pointing fingers, middle finger at me, screaming, booing, whistling. And this is about the 35th moment, minute in the game. And I had a moment there, and I was thinking, I can remember that moment when everybody's booing me. The entire city is behind me. Or against me, not behind me, against me. And I remember, how am I going to finish this game? I can't. I want to walk. I want to hide. I want to go home. I don't want to play this game anymore. Why am I doing this? I don't need this. And I remember these thoughts in my head. and I had to continue to play the game. And I played, finished the game 90 minutes. We ended up losing 2-1. I hit the post. Just nothing was going right. I remember the next day, I was already getting slaughtered, but the next day in the media and the papers, fans showed up at our stadium. It was my fault. It was me. The entire city of Berlin was my fault. And I wanted to quit. I was 27 at the time, peak of my career. And I said, I don't need this. Why am I doing this? It's not worth it. It's not worth it. And I remember I looked at myself in the mirror that night, and I just wanted to crawl under a rock and never come up. And I just said, you know what? I'm going to take every moment, every day, and come out of this funk and work my absolute ass off and come out of this. This is the only way out of this, is roll my sleeves up. I'm going to handle this. I'm going to take it. I don't care anymore. And let's go. From that moment on, I had a different mentality, a different approach. And it was that moment I got like an extra inch of my skin of thickness. And that sort of adversity is really what's continued to drive me through life and business. Yeah. So that would be one particular moment.
Yeah. Thanks for sharing that. I appreciate that. It's hard to get a negative comment on Facebook sometimes, never mind having 60,000 people pointing a finger at you in the middle of a game. So I'd love you to just, without necessarily even describing it, because I'm really conscious of getting on to people who have questions for you and things like that. And I want to respect the fact that, you know, we've got kids on the call and we've got coaches on the call and we've got members of the committee on the call. And just for some context, Rob, you know, Kinvara is I would say with respect, a small town on Ireland's west coast. And soccer would be maybe not the number one sport in the community. You know, GAA or Gaelic Games is significant, but there's over 400 members, I believe, and growing steadily. And we're looking for our own home in the future, so we can secure the club. And that's a vision that the committee have, and the people at the top of the team and the club have for the future of the club, etc. Short and sweet, Rob. Just no real context. Just the best goal you ever scored.
The best goal I ever scored, the nicest goal, and it's still on YouTube and I still pull it up in front of my kids once a month, as I become less cool as a 41-year-old dad. there was a goal against Alemanniak and, 60,000 people is the derby for Borussia Mönchengladbach. And I received it and, I looked very fast when I watched it on YouTube. I wasn't a fast player. I was a big, tall striker. And I received the ball and I had this surge of adrenaline. I can still remember it. And I received it and I chipped outside my foot. Didn't know, looked like I knew what I was doing, but I didn't. I wasn't a finesse player. Chipped it over the goalie. Crowd erupted. We won the game. I think it was 1-0, the big derby. And so, yeah, if you ever want to it's on the YouTube page. Yeah.
We're just missing you a little bit. We're losing you a little bit in terms of sound and video. I don't know if you can still hear me.
Yeah, I still hear you.
Okay.
I gotcha.
Rob, you've mentioned before, you know, there's often this perception that focus is the key. You know, in other words, you take a sport, you take a discipline, you take a business, and you just focus on that wholeheartedly. You play no other sport, nothing. A lot of the young kids are you know, that are listening in today, the young men that are listening today, and girls and women, you know, they're maybe hearing this or feeling this. And I remember having a conversation with you a number of years ago about this idea of actually playing different sports, because as I mentioned earlier on, Gaelic Games is perhaps a game that maybe a lot of the kids play, and they also play football, like soccer, or they play soccer, maybe they play hockey and whatever. And a lot of people think that they should be focusing on one sport. What's your take on that?
Yeah, no, I'm certainly the opposite there. You know, myself personally, I was a multi-sport athlete. I played at a high level until I was 18, two or three other sports, volleyball, basketball. I've skied, I played tennis. And really, I attribute my career, my success to being a multi-sport athlete. And I didn't get burnt out. You know, playing in Germany, where really there was one sport, these kids only knew football, knew soccer. And you notice like the burnout that these guys had dropping out at an early age. You're seeing that more and more. I've got a 12-year-old boy. We talk about that a lot. You know, the pressure in society and sports from your coaches to focus on one sport. I absolutely disagree with that. I think from mentally, the burnout, physically, I think it's extremely important to be that multi-sport athlete from muscle development, from injuries, because I tell people, once you hit the pro levels or once you reach that highest level, you're training every day, playing every day that one sport, you're going to be grateful. Your body's going to be grateful. You're going to be better for it by being a multi-sport athlete. And so to me, it's a massive advantage in any sport you play. And eventually you will focus.
Yeah.
And if you have the more sports, the more activities you played, you're going to be better off as you try to achieve the higher level in the one sport you choose, 100%.
Love it. Love it. Thank you. Best player you ever played against, like the player that you got on the pitch and you had a sense of who they were, but when they blasted either past you, around you, in the distance, took the ball off you, it was just like a kind of a holy shit moment. It's like, oh my God, they're good. Like who just comes to mind?
Well, I've played against Cristiano Ronaldo when we played Real Madrid in a friendly. I actually don't remember him being that type of player, as a friendly. But I do remember him being extremely nice, shaking our hand, being very humble, actually, on the field towards us. But the moment, I would say Canada played against Argentina before one of the World Cups. I can't remember what year it was. We went down to Buenos Aires, and Messi was on that team. You had a defender called Mascherano, who I think is retired. He was a Barcelona defender. You have a lot of the current players that are still playing for Argentina. We're on that team. We end up getting thumped 5-0. I was obviously a striker. I think I touched the ball 2 times. But I remember Mascherano, who was obviously a big player at Barcelona for many years, man marked me. And I don't know if he saw some sort of scouting report, but he didn't leave my side. And I'm 6'5", 220 pounds. I'm strong. No one could ever touch me. I would just push them off, out-muscle them. And I remember Mascherano, he was about 5'11", 6', not huge in comparison to me. I remember I couldn't move the guy. And I remember thinking after that game, or probably in the middle of that game, that I'm playing a different sport. Like these guys, this is the next level. And I was playing in the Bundesliga, obviously, at the time, playing against Bayern Munich. So obviously a lot of big clubs and players and top world-class players I played against. But when you go against that top elite, I knew that this is a different league, and I knew right there that, wow, I've need to improve if I want to continue to strive for the highest level. That moment, and I still remember to this day thinking in the 60th minute, and you never want these negative thoughts in your head. You get them thinking, this is nuts. This guy is a different level. So that was definitely one experience there.
Best player you've ever played with?
People ask me who I played with. Marco Reus, who's now currently a German national team player, Dortmund. Ter Stegen, who's the Barcelona goalie. He was a young up-and-coming goalie as a teammate of mine. But I'd say overall, Robbie Keane, who's an Irishman, my last year in LA Galaxy. Robbie was something special. And I don't think Robbie wasn't born. And to me, this is what's interesting. He wasn't a phenomenal athlete. Wasn't born with speed. But the guy, his cleverness, he was 3 seconds ahead of everyone else. His mind was so sharp and fast. When he received the ball, he had that field scanned like I've never seen. And I think that probably attributes to him growing up not being the best player. And I asked him about that. And growing up in Ireland, and he wasn't the fastest, strongest, best kid out there. And I think he had to use mentally his mind how to be ahead of the other players. And that's one thing I took with Robbie was, and especially as a strike partner, he was 3 steps ahead at all times. And that to me was a difference maker and why he had such a world-class career.
I remember you telling me one time, and some of our listeners or watchers today might be surprised that you pick Robbie when you mentioned some of these other names. But I remember you telling me at the time, and correct me if I'm wrong, I could be way off, but you and I had a drink one night. I probably bought the drink as usual. But anyway, I'll leave that aside. You mentioned that you'd go out onto the pitch with Robbie, and whatever way he reacted, you knew you were going to win the game, or there was something like that. Can you remember what you said to me?
Yeah. And I it was probably my 4th drink. So I actually don't remember particularly what I said, but I think what, in terms of Robbie and the context there is he was a pure winner and a pure competitor. And he literally, we won the MLS Cup that year, a championship, and he carried that team as a leader. And you knew when you stepped on the field with Robbie, he brought an expectation. You did not want to screw up, mess up, or fail Robbie. Forget about the club. Wow. Forget about the history. It was you don't want to let Robbie down. And he didn't say anything to you. There was just this level of expectation that he brought, and it elevated everybody. Yeah. And it was very interesting. And he brought that, and he had that aura. And it was very
interesting. I've got one more comment or question. Just want to get your opinion on it. And then I want to push it over to questions for the last, say, 15 minutes. We've got about 45 minutes penciled in. We're almost 30 minutes in. So I've got connections in extremely high places. And I managed to get a lot of old footage across the world of you playing. And I got a sound engineer. And he went in the Bundesliga, and he took all the German voices out. And we searched for one English-speaking person, and we found one voice consistent across the world. And it was an older gentleman with a Canadian accent shouting, "Get up, Rob. Get up, Rob." So I've done my digging. A certain little birdie told me that your dad used to sit in the stadium shouting, "Get up, Rob." Can you give us a bit of context? I'm definitely throwing you under the bus on this one. But
you are. You are. No, that's funny, because it's a funny story, because yes, as I was younger, I was always flopping, always on the ground. And if you ask my dad, you know, growing up, the first thing he says, the damn kid was always on the ground, always falling. And it drove me nuts, drove me crazy. And my dad he never played the game. He was old school, you know, in the middle of Canada, grew up on a farm. American football is what he played. So, but it drove him nuts. And even as a pro, it was every time I was on the ground, he would just say, "Jesus, get up, Rob," is what he'd say. And it's funny now, because as a father with a 12-year-old boy that plays, I think he inherited that skill set from me, my son. And we joke with Philip that our boys, when they play, little ants tackle them constantly. They're always on the ground, complaining, falling. And we're like, "Oh, the ant got you again." So it's, I think it's an inherited trait, and he's definitely improved. Phil, I'd say that.
Good.
Lucas has.
Good.
So, but yeah, that's a funny story.
Well, listen, I want to put it over to Q&A. One thing I want to mention is the jersey I'm wearing is Pacific FC, which are based on Vancouver Island. And one of the most beautiful comments I've heard, kind of joking aside, is when myself and Rob have a good few jokes at each other or at each other's expense, is his wife, Mary, commenting after Pacific FC won the CPL, the Canadian Premier League. And the league itself is going 3 years. And Rob, when he set up the team, and we haven't talked about the crossover from professional football to owning a club, which is a whole other conversation, maybe for a different day. But 3 years later, they lifted the championship, they lifted the cup, and won the CPL, which is an enormous feat and a huge, you know, just a huge shout out to you and the vision that you created in the team. And I've been very fortunate to witness and be a fly in the wall and a little part of that journey. So I just want to acknowledge that. And this is, I had to wear this jersey tonight, even though Kinvara United will probably throw me out. But listen, I wanted to put it over to questions for the rest of the time. Has anybody got a question? If you could just unmute yourself. Paul, maybe I'll go to you first, because I know you had a couple of questions lined up. Paul is our PRO, Public Relations Officer, and he still attempts to play, even though he probably should have retired 10 years ago. But over to you, Paul.
Wow. Did that just happen?
sorry, I couldn't help it.
I thought this was supposed to be motivational, Philip, and you've just ended my career in one line. I was going to say, it might be easier actually, guys, as well. If anybody wants to ask a question, just you can raise your hand there. You have a reactions option there on Zoom as well, so that might be easier as well. Rob, I thank you very much, by the way, for giving the time. I can see the camera wobbling there on the ferry. I was just going to say, I suppose, did you model your game on anybody in particular? You know, as a and I'm a Javier Mascherano size player, so as the other end of that, did you model your game on anyone in particular? Is there anyone you kind of aspired to kind of play like, or was it more your own stuff?
Yeah, no, I think, I mean, growing up in Canada, we didn't have the idols in this country, and it was hard growing up as a young kid to watch football. I think it was once a week, you might get a Premier League game. So we never had idols. In Canada, we had hockey idols. Wayne Gretzky was the big idol. So every kid and their cousin was idolizing Wayne Gretzky. That was it. And it was just this iconic athlete. As I got older and started, you know, having more, obviously, at collegiate level and looking to go pro, I would sort of just target the strikers, the bigger strikers, and watch their game and take bits and pieces. So there was a guy named Jan Kohler. He was a big German, or he played in Germany at Dortmund. I kind of watched him. I'm like, wow, that guy's 6'7". Interesting how he plays. So I take bits and pieces there. The time Ibrahimovic was a big striker coming up. You know, so little bits and pieces, and would kind of watch them, watch their movement. So it wasn't one particular player. It was just sort of getting bits and pieces and then carving my own little niche out in my game. And I think that's how I became successful. I was a very unique type of striker, brought my own skill set, you know, but obviously it is important. And I definitely say that, to watch players in your position and not just one, different types of players, and sort of have them as a mentor, you know, as you watch them. I definitely said that is important.
Cool. Great question. Anybody else like to ask a question? Cheers. As Paul said, raise a hand or, you know,
just. Yeah. Hi, Philip. It's Ronan.
Hi, Ronan.
I have a question for Rob. Firstly, Rob, thanks a lot for your time. But I'm going to hit you with kind of a pointed question. What's the best advice you could give to the coaches and players that are on this call so that they can really get the most out of their soccer? And I'm hoping you can give us a power statement that we can reuse across all of our teams. So I'm looking to call on your experience from a pro and a team owner, just to see if you can give us something that may be a mantra that we can use so that, as I say, the players and coaches can really get the most out of their soccer.
Jesus, Ronan, that's deep.
Yep.
No pressure there either.
And the audio fails.
Sorry, Rob, go ahead. Yeah, we got you back now.
On purpose. Can you guys hear me?
Yeah, we got you.
We can.
I did that on purpose. I needed some time. I'd say, look, I mean, I think there's sort of principles I personally live by in my life, and it translated in my career. And now on the other side, as a business, as a pro team owner, owning my own team and building the club from scratch. You know, and I think it's a few principles that I personally have lived by. And I think it's, again, in anything I touch, anything I do, it's sort of guiding principles. And never grab them in terms of, you know, motivational notes that I have, but it's simple things. And it's to me, it's discipline. It's hard work. It's humility. I think it's a very important thing. And I see these young kids coming up now, because now on the other side, we're recruiting kids. And to me, number one is character. When you're looking at these kids, what sort of character they have, because honestly, there's too many good players out there, and who's making it, who's not. And it's not about who kicks the ball better, who controls the ball better. I think truly it's really what sets you apart is your character, because skill will only get you so far. And any kid who's aspiring is, you know, whether, you know, whatever level you want to reach or a coach, I think it's how you approach it with your character. And, you know, and that's everything, to hard work, to humility, to honesty, to all these sort of traits that come with it, because that's what's going to get you. And it's whatever you approach, to me, that's the most important part of it. So, I mean, Ronan, give me some time next time, and I'll write something
sure.
more deep for you, but you put me on the spot. And again, I think it, again, translates into my new career of owning this club and hiring on the business side, hiring coaches, hiring technical staff and recruiting players. And my objective owning this club is to take young players and sell them. We just recently did a great transfer from one of our young guys into Toronto Football Club, which is a big club in the MLS here. You know, and he didn't get signed because of his skill. And he was one of the guys who had probably hands down the best character on the team. And he made it. And it's not saying he didn't make it at our team, but he's made that level, making really good money now and sort of reached his goal. And that got him there. So
great.
That helps. Yep.
So, Rob, maybe I'll give you a get out of jail card with a second question, if that's okay. What was the eureka moment when you knew you were going to be a footballer? That was going to be your career. Was there a light bulb moment?
The funny enough, there wasn't really, actually. And this is what's interesting. People ask me, well, what's the best path for my son? What's the best path for me to take to become a pro? And there's not one clear path. I was 18. I had offers to play other sports, to go play at the collegiate level. And really what I did is I set goals. And those were sort of smaller goals, is go to university, score X amount of goals, perform at this level. And it was never, I want to go play in the Bundesliga. Never, not once did I ever set that goal. So it was these small little ladders, ladder goals that I would set. So right here, the next one, focus on the next one. And it was never set this monster goal, I'm going to be a pro. It was always, and then, okay, so how am I going to get in this small goal? So I'm at university year two, I've got 10 goals. How do I need to get to 15 goals this next season? That was it. It wasn't, how do I get to 20 goals and sign a pro contract? It was 10 to 15 goals. What do I need to do to get there? Okay, so have I done enough training? Am I doing extra before and after? How's my nutrition? And then next season, I reset goal. I surpassed it. Okay, what's with the next goal? And it was, that was really it. And then I had my first pro contract in Norway. And it wasn't like, okay, Norway, Bundesliga. It was, okay, so what's my targets here and how am I going to get there? So it was really setting these small little targets that allowed me to just climb that ladder. And that was it, simple as that. And there wasn't one clear pathway, you know? So, and I had, most people told me I'd never make it. And that's the honest truth. You're too slow. You're not skilled enough. You're not going to make it. Never in a million years did people think I'd make it. And that motivated me too. So I think that's very important as a young kid, as an aspiring player, is just because one kid went down one path or made that team, it doesn't matter. Set these little goals to get you to achieve those goals to the next level.
Cool. Great. Anybody Thanks for that, Rob.
Anybody else got questions? I'd love to hear from some of the younger adults on the call, if that's a possibility, if they have any questions. If not, I'm sure we can come up with some more. Paul, I know you.
We have a question from Rory here. He's one of the goalkeepers of the men's team, so he's not a young player. But we have a question from Rory there.
Yeah, Rory, how you doing?
Hey, how's it going? Once again, thanks, mate, Rob, for coming on.
Rory, if I could ask you just to turn up your volume or just speak a little bit closer to the mic, please.
I'm on my phone here, so maybe does that work?
It's a little bit better. Go ahead. Yeah.
Yeah, I'll go from that. Thanks, Minion Rob, for coming on and speaking with us today. It's great. It's a real pleasure to have you with us. I suppose I have two questions. The first one would be, what would be your ideal match day preparation? And the second,
if we can just do one question at a time, please.
Cool. Yeah, no problem.
Please, thank you. Did you hear that okay, Rob?
Yeah, I got it. Thanks, Rory. Ideal match day prep. Again, I think that's very individual, and there's not one. So I think it's really just what's best for your body. And it takes time to figure that one out. Certainly I would say there's gotta be some sort of activation before in the morning when you wake up. And I think I actually apply this to my post career life is your morning. What are you doing with that first hour, to sort of energize your nervous system? Water right away, hit it right away, throw some lemon in it, kind of do shake your body, do some sort of movement. If you can get outside, get your bare feet on the ground, look at the sun a little bit, just to get your body awake and tell your body it's ready to go versus getting up, looking at your phone, kind of being lethargic. So I think that to me would be the first sort of hour and a half is to sort of give your body that chance to be energized. Throw some water in your face. I jump in the ocean every day now. So kind of give me that little hit. And then after that, I think it's just, having the right nutrition, fluids, sort of from a nutritional standpoint. But I would say the first hour and a half is your most important time to give yourself the energy and telling your body to be ready.
If I could just jump in on one thing, and then I want to hear Rory's second part of it, but I want to just play a piece of music. I don't know if you can hear this. I believe that
he pulls that out every time, doesn't he?
I believe that's a song that you used to play just before games. Is that true?
That is. That is my song. Gives me goosebumps right now. And you pull it out every time on me, don't you?
I play that because I think Rory's question is a great question. And I'm a believer in, I think music can really move us. And I'm just curious, you know, what did a song like that or what did music do before a game? Rory, if you don't mind me just jumping on your question a little bit.
Yeah, no, it's great. I mean, I haven't heard that song since the last time you played it when I had to go on one of your stages. You threw me under the bus there. I get goosebumps. And no, music to me is a huge part. And again, I think that's individual. But I think most people can relate to a song. Depending on the mood. And I think, yeah, motivational song, as simple as it is, I think is very deep and puts you into that zone and puts you into that flow. And the minute I hear that song, honestly, I'm ready for battle. Like you play that and it's like, let's go. And it's I think it's finding those songs that pull that out of you. And that's my battle song. Love anytime. It. I'm going to start using it for meetings now. I need that.
Liz, I want to go back to just to honor Rory's second part of the question. Rory, you're up again.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I'll come closer to the microphone myself just to give my question. I suppose the second part was it's sort of what do you hate in a goalkeeper when you're coming up one on one with him or one on one with whatever goalkeeper you're coming up against, and equally what's going through your head? What do you think? It's a game of chess. So I'm just wondering, like, for tips for the goalkeeper from a striker, and equally on the other side, tips for strikers coming up against the top goalkeeper.
So I think as a striker, the most important is instinct. And the minute you have too much time to think, ask any player, any striker. The minute you second guess it, you're done. The keeper's read you. So I think the most important thing as a striker, and then obviously you as a goalie, is instinctual reacting, and that comes with practice, and that's what I would always do in practice is repetition. So when in the game it came, I didn't have to think; I knew, because the minute I thought, and at the highest level, the goalie knows it. The goalie knows when there's that half a second the guy's thinking, and then your body is positioning itself in the wrong direction. Or giving the position away, and the goalie can read that absolutely. How that would apply to a goalie, that's a great question. I don't know how goalies think. You guys are always a little bit off. So, but I think for a goalie, reading the body language is the most important of your striker, and I think that's a skill that you need to learn over time. Is see, you can almost read the body language, the confidence, and then reading the striker or the player at that moment would be the most important, because from my side of things, that was it. Because the minute my mind came into the play, I was done. I wasn't scoring. Got in my head.
Rob, we've got about 5 minutes left. And if there's, maybe I'll take one more question. If anybody's got a question, just raise your hand. That'd be super. Anybody else before we move on? Nobody else? Yeah, we have somebody. It's David Noon, but it's not David Noon, but I'm assuming that's David's son. Do you want to unmute yourself? Yeah, how are you?
Yeah, how are you? I was just wondering, Rob, what do you do in your free time when you weren't training or playing matches?
Well, I hate to say this, but I wasn't a video gamer. And honestly, I was the guy on the bus, reading books, reading business books, educating myself. And I still do that to this day. And look, I get young kids, they like video games, they like social media. But what I would say, and I'm seeing this with these young players that we're recruiting for our pro team, being well balanced is the most important thing, because your career is going to end, whether you're, you know, a young aspiring player, whether you're looking to play in college or professionally. One day that time's going to come to an end, and playing video games for 4 to 8 hours a day I'm not saying it's bad. I'm not an anti-video gamer, but I think it's just being balanced, reading books, learning, educating, developing yourself, because very important to not just be, you know, sort of one-sided. I think you need hobbies. You need other interests, because when the time comes and you're not that football player anymore, it's a hard thing to swallow. And if you don't have other interests or other passions that you need to learn as you're playing, it's very dangerous place. And you could talk to any professional that didn't have these sort of other balances. And Phil and I've talked about that a lot, post-career stuff, and it's very important. So that's what I would say. I'd recommend, you know, diving into educational books, listen to podcasts, learn, develop yourself, because you need to find those other interests, because you're not going to be a footballer the rest of your life. And or maybe it's a coach. If you want to become a coach or stay in the game, learn that. So I think that's very important as a young player.
Cool. Thank you. We weren't going to take any more questions, but Kevin Sexton has his hand up. And if I don't go to Kevin, I'll never hear the end of it. So, Kevin, do you want to ask a question? Or is it Kevin? You guys are muted just right now, so you need to unmute.
Stuck on mute there, lads. Yeah. Just watch the mute.
You need to unmute. Guys, got the
whole... Yeah, sorry. It's actually my son, Ethan. Hi, Philip. How are
Ethan,
you?
How are you?
Rob, thanks for coming on.
Hey, guys.
Quick question here.
What was your signature celebration after you scored?
Signature celebration. Well, funny enough, I used to do the old school, pull the jersey over the face and do an airplane where you kind of hands out. And then they started giving yellow cards for that celebration. After they started handing yellow cards for flipping your jersey up, it was just reactive. And honestly, as you guys know, scoring a goal is the best feeling in the world, no matter what level you're at. And I think it's just reacting to that and feeling at that moment. Also depends on the situation. If you're losing 5-0, you score a goal, you probably shouldn't go crazy with the celebration. I'd recommend that. But if you score the game winner, you know, just let the emotions go, because it's the best feeling in the world.
Cool. Well, Rob, I want to give thanks for the question. I want to give the last word to you. You know, you're up to, you know, we've obviously talked very frankly about certain things. So I don't want to give away what is happening behind the scenes in terms of the vision and the big vision that you have in terms of football. But, you know, not just are you the owner of Pacific FC and setting that club up, but you've got different aspirations, but also you're involved in Canadian football. I don't know how that works, that you own the national team and you own the women's and so on and so forth. But, you know, soccer in Canada is on a trajectory. It's staggering on every single level. It's the biggest, I believe, developed country in the world that didn't have its own professional league until 3 years ago. The Canadian men's team won two nights ago after first time in 37 years beating Honduras. They're top of the league. It looks like they're going to the World Cup. They're hosting the World Cup. I mean, it's just on fire right now. So the question, I suppose, is where do you see yourself, or where do you see soccer going over the next 3 to 5 years, knowing that you take steps rather than these big audacious goals? And I'm just curious.
Yeah, no. I mean, obviously in the last 3-4 years, I'd say last 4 years, I dove into this project of starting a league in this country, and myself and 7 other investors, we invested to start our own, this professional league, Canadian Premier League. Part of that was in the cultural rights of Canada soccer. It's a long story in terms of how we got to that business model, but it's a very exciting time. We were, you know, in Europe, people ask, like, Canada's known as a hockey nation. We're number one in the world in hockey. And I've always said, how can we not be, you know, top 10 in the world in football? And we were, you know, top 10 developed nation in the world. Why can't we get there? And we've always had the numbers, participation levels, but just it culturally, it wasn't there. And I'm embarking on this project. I'm 4 years in. We've won this league. I've started a second professional team in Vancouver now that we're starting next year. We're building infrastructure. We're investing in this game. And it's a very, very exciting time as a footballer. And really, again, I tell people, we are the last developed nation in this world to really dive into this sport. And we're so premature as a nation. US took 25 years with the MLS and what they're doing, and finally reaching the World Cup to get where they're at. I think they're top 10 in the world now. They're a powerhouse, and Americans don't mess around. And we're sort of now, we're 20 years behind the US, but we're coming on fast. And it's a very exciting time to be in this country. selfishly as a business. It's a very interesting business time in the game, and we're trying to capitalize on that, because ultimately, as the business is successful, we can reinvest in the game, reinvest in infrastructure, develop kids at a professional level. So yeah, that's what I'm living and breathing and eating right now every single day, is how can I improve the game here in this country and give opportunities for young kids. And that's what I wake up, and that's what I'm passionate about. And
we just lost Rob there. He might come back to us in a second. Can you hear us, Rob?
Yeah, sorry. Yeah. Wi-Fi kicked in and Rob, kicked me off
I'm gonna leave it there, because I want to be respectful of your time and also everyone who joined us here today. But I want to say thanks a million for not just who you are. I've gotten to know you personally. It's very difficult for me being nice to you today on the call. But I suppose I have to be. I love you. I love your family. It's been amazing to get to know you. And it's been a great and such a pleasure to introduce you to the guys and girls who joined us today. So if you want to continue, obviously, I would encourage you to have a look at Pacific FC in the Canadian Premier League. Follow what they're doing. You'll get a sense of what Rob and his group are up to, and the vision they have for the future. And also keep an eye out for the next pro talks that are coming up, you know, in the next little bit. And we'll go from there. Rob, thanks a million for joining us, and we'll talk soon.
Yeah, no, thanks a lot, Phil. Yeah, follow us on Pacific FC on Instagram is probably our best site. And thanks for your support. And anytime, reach out, Phil. Have me on again. I love it. Anytime.
All right. Rob, if you're ever in Kinvara, our men's team has a spot for you there. You know, our registrar is on the call here. He can get you registered, and we'll get you in the jersey whenever you make it.
As long as Phil's not on the team, I'm in.
Phil's not allowed. No, he's not allowed near you.
Hey, Rob, whatever about playing, Rob, you're welcome in Kinvara anytime. So
yeah, I told Phil we're going to visit this summer, so come say hi to you guys.
Yeah, they're coming over.
Listen, thanks very much.
Cheers, Rob. Thank you very much.
Thanks, guys. Appreciate it.
See you guys. Thank you.
Have a good one. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thanks.
See you guys. Thank you.